Ken Follett, and thank you so much for allowing La Librairie Mola in Bordeaux to this remote interview. We are here today to discuss your latest book, The Evening and the Morning, which was published in French by Les Éditions Robert Laffont under the title Le Crépuscule et l'Aube. This book is number 4 in your Kingsbridge series, which started 30 years ago with The Pillars of the Earth, was followed by World Without End, and by Column of Fire, three years ago. A Column of Fire was set during the Renaissance. The Renaissance is this end of an era and the beginning of a new one. And in The Evening and the Morning, as the title shows, your interest is also to study a turning point in the history of your country and in the history of Kingsbridge, because it's about Kingsbridge before the bridge was built. So could you tell us a bit more about the situation of England in 997 at the beginning of your book? And could you explain us why is the island so vulnerable?
Well, the Dark Ages were coming to an end at the end of the 10th century, and the Middle Ages were beginning. And so that's a turning point in itself. But in addition, for England, there were three powerful groups competing for control of England. And they were the Anglo-Saxons, of course, who lived there, the Vikings, who were raiders, pirates, thieves, and the Normans in France, in northern France, who also had their eye on England. And as everybody knows, it was the Normans who ended up conquering England and ruling England for hundreds of years. But round about the year 1000, of course, nobody knew who was going to win this contest. So for me, as a storyteller, the idea of a three-way contest is wonderful. There are many, many opportunities for good stories.
I imagine it's much more difficult to find sources about the early Middle Ages than, let's say, the Renaissance. So you've probably read a lot about this period, but I know that you like to visit places, to feel, to see the things you are going to write about. So what places did you visit and what were your main sources for this book?
Well, it's true that it's quite difficult to discover details of everyday life in the Anglo-Saxon period. This is really, and it's the same in every European country, the period between the departure of the Romans and the beginning of the Middle Ages, it's a period of very little progress, very little was written down, very few buildings were built in stone, and of course there were plenty of wooden buildings, but they have all rotted away. There are some artifacts, weapons and jewelry and coins and pottery, of course, always lots of broken pottery. But it is quite difficult. Now, I found two sources of information very helpful. One is the Bayeux Tapestry, which is in the city of Bayeux, obviously. And this is, for anybody who's watching who doesn't know, this is a kind of medieval strip cartoon. Une bande dessinée in French. Indeed. And it tells the story of the Norman invasion of England, but it also has lots of details of everyday life during this period. We see people having lunch, people chopping down trees, building boats. We see people with their dogs, people on horseback, of course. Horses were terribly important at this point in history. And so I visited Bayeux twice to look at the tapestry. There's also a copy of the tapestry in England in a museum in the town of Reading, an accurate copy made in the 19th century. Why, I don't know, but 40 English women from the city of Manchester decided to make a copy, embroider a copy of the Bayeux tapestry. And they did it accurately. And so we can actually look at this copy in England. And of course, there are many reproductions. All the time I was writing The Evening and the Morning, I had this little book on my desk. and it contains reproductions of every frame of the Bayeux tapestry with all the little details that a novelist really loves to have. There was one item that I could not discover from any source. I wanted to know what kind of underwear was worn in the Dark Ages, and nobody knows. So in the end, I had to make something up, and what I decided was probably most of the time they didn't wear underwear, but then if they needed to, for example, when they're riding on horses, they might just take a length of cloth and wrap it around themselves like a loincloth. And that's my guess, and probably we will never know whether I was right. So as well as the Bayeux tapestry, the other great visit I made while researching this book was to Oslo in Norway, because there's a museum there called the Viking Ship Museum. And it's a marvelous museum because they have two full-size Viking ships, not reproductions, actually ships that they've dug up out of the mud. Some repairs, but these ships are 90% the original wood, which is amazing that they would have survived underground for 1,000 years, but they did. And so you walk into the ship museum and you see this beautiful, big ship. And of course, that moment in my visit inspired the opening chapter of The Evening and the Morning, because immediately I thought, this ship is graceful, but it's menacing. Mm. And of course, they went very fast. Those Viking ships were very fast. So I imagined somebody standing on a beach in England, looking out to sea and seeing maybe 20 of these very scary looking ships coming towards him across the water. And he would know that hell was coming to town.
Yeah, absolutely. And about the Vikings, because they are not the main characters in your book, but they are omnipresent in the story. So we discover the Vikings through your characters' eyes during organized raids and lootings, as you mentioned. Do we have traces in England of these raids? Because I know that, for example, we do have traces of their invasion of Rouen or Paris in the 9th century. So can we find traces of their invasions in England?
Yes, there are several sites in England where Viking remains have been excavated. Helmets, I think there's only one helmet. Swords, jewellery. Like the Anglo-Saxons, they didn't build anything in stone, so there's no such thing as a Viking building. An interesting trace we have of them is in place names, because many of the Vikings settled in England, and they gave new names to the places, the villages where they settled, and some of those names still exist. So you can sometimes tell from the name of a place that it was once a Viking settlement. We don't have very many Scandinavian words in the English language, but there are one or two. So there are traces. They were people. They didn't make very much of a permanent mark on our country, whereas, of course, the Normans, who arrived and threw the Vikings out, left enormous marks on, you know, made a huge difference. I mean, we're not an Anglo-Saxon country. We're a mixture of Anglo-Saxon and Norman.
So you said earlier that you had to imagine a lot of things about the everyday life of these people. But you mentioned slavery in your book, and slavery in our 21st century Western minds is not something that we easily link to early Middle Ages, but it was central to the organization of the territory. And you mentioned something like voluntary slavery, which sounds to me like a contradiction in terms. So what is voluntary slavery, and how is slavery important at this time?
Well, it's important because 10% of the population of England were slaves at this time. It's a huge number. And it clearly marks England as a slave society. And for me, writing about this period, it means that I could not ignore slavery, and I couldn't even allow slavery to be a sort of a thing that happens in the background. Clearly, when something is this big, then I had to have characters who were slaves in the story, and I had to have, and they had to do things. They had to be in the story, not just, as it were, a part of the background. So, the historians of this period are a bit bashful about slavery. They want to say, well, it wasn't that important, it wasn't that bad. I think slavery is always very bad. Slave owners are always very cruel. And so there are cruel aspects to this story. Now, voluntary slavery, it's hard to know how common it was. There are certainly laws about voluntary slavery. And what happened was, if people were completely destitute, they could sort of sell themselves. If they had no money, no work, no land, nothing to eat, they're starving, they have nowhere to live, they could throw themselves on the mercy of a nobleman, and they could say, I will be your slave. Okay. And it was a simple ceremony. The person would kneel down in front of the nobleman. He would put a hand on the person's head, and that person would be his slave for life, but he would feed and give clothes to this person and give the person a place to sleep. So that was voluntary slavery. I don't know how often it happened. Theoretically, then, people could buy themselves out of slavery, but since slaves never had any money, that can't have happened very much, and have happened very often. And it's interesting fact, by the beginning of my story, the end of the 10th century, year 997, slavery had pretty much been abolished in Normandy.
Yes.
And the English were just a little behind. It was abolished eventually, a couple of hundred years later, slavery died out in England as well. But it's interesting that the Normans were ahead of the English. And I think my own feeling is that the Norman society was more advanced and more sophisticated. And the church was more important in Norman civilization than in Anglo civilization. And the church was against slavery. Mm. Actually, not because they believed it was wrong to own people, but actually because slaves are always used for prostitution, male and female slaves, yeah. And the church disapproved of that. And so the church disapproved of slavery. So that's it. It's a complex situation, but there's absolutely no doubt that it was an important part of life at this time.
Because you mentioned a few differences between Normandy at the time and the English territory. And I think one of the main elements in your book is the notion of power and how this power is obtained by law or by the absence of it. So there are some differences, for example, in terms of what some would call morality, like bigamy or married priests, but also in the organization of the territory itself. For example, the freedom of the peasants, the importance of general consent in a trial, and also the actual true power of the king, which is very different in Normandy, in the Frank territory, and in the Anglo-Saxon territory. So how yes. does all these notions of power works in English at the time, in England at the time?
Well, I think the strongest evidence of the sophistication of Norman society at this time is the castles. Mm. The Normans had started building castles, and I visited one of them in there's a small town about 30 miles outside Paris called Ivry-la-Bataille. Mm. Mm-hmm. And there's a wonderful Norman castle there that was built originally. The original parts of it were built around about the year 900. So, and there were no castles in England at this time. English people, the English did not know how to build castles. They learned from the Normans when the Normans invaded. But also the Normans had a more effective structure of government.
Yeah.
And so in Norman territories, the law could be enforced. And Anglo-Saxon society was much more loosely organized, and it was pretty much impossible to enforce the law. Power was in the hands of noblemen, and the king had great trouble enforcing the law on the noblemen. So it was a much looser social structure, and one of the consequences, which is very important in the evening and the morning, is that it was difficult to enforce the law. There were lots of laws. Every other Anglo-Saxon king commissioned somebody to make a book of laws. So there were loads of books of laws. And that the having laws wasn't the problem. Enforcing laws was the problem. And somebody, if a nobleman wanted to defy the king, it was very difficult for the king to overrule him. And similarly, if people went to court, to the shire court or the hundred court, to demand justice, it was really up to the nobleman to decide. Yeah. There was no law that was independent of the nobility. And this has, we call this the rule of law, when even the noblemen are subject to the law. That's what we have in France today and in England and most West European countries. The president and the prime minister and the king, if you have one, they have to obey the law just like everybody else. And that's an important principle, the rule of law. And it, the principle was not followed at this time, hadn't been thought of really 1,000 years ago. And the consequences of not having the rule of law are shown in the evening and the morning, because people who seek justice don't usually get it, because the courts are run by the noblemen. So if the government does something wrong, there's nothing you can do about it. Now, in France or Britain today, if the government does something illegal, you can, an individual can go to court and say this is illegal, and the court will rule according to the law. But they didn't have that. And it is the other reason why it's interesting. I mean, it's very dramatic, of course, in mm-hmm. in my story. Yeah. People who are treated unjustly try and find justice. But also it's important because in some countries today, the rule of law is being challenged. President Trump, for example, who doesn't like anybody to stand in his way, he thinks he should control the courts. The government of Poland today think they should control the courts. They don't like the idea of independent courts. And there are several other countries where the rule of law is under challenge. So the story, although it's set 1,000 years ago, does have some relevance for today.
Yes, and your three main characters are emblematic of this new era that is coming. And especially my favorite, Ragna, of course, a very, very strong woman. She's got quite a strong personality. And she's from Cherbourg in Normandy. She crosses the sea to marry Wilf, the older man of Shiring. And I think that you were inspired to create this character by a woman who lived at the exact same time, Emma of Normandy. She was the wife of the king Ethelred the Ill-Advised, which is not a very good surname. So what's the story behind the character of Ragna?
Well, she, as you said, she comes to England to marry the man she loves. And she becomes a powerful person in the region. And I'm often asked about the There is, in all of my books, there is at least one woman like Ragnar who has a strong personality. Indeed. And is a rebel and refuses to obey the rules and so on. And I'm sometimes asked, is this really historically possible? And the answer is yes. In every period of history, there are people who refuse to accept the role that society offers them, particularly women. And we see powerful women in every period of history, women who have broken the rules and succeeded. And at this time, around about the year 1000, there was a woman called Emma of Normandy, and she married the English king, Ethelred. And when he died, she married the next king, who was called Canute. He was a Viking. And when Canute died, her son, Edward, became King of England. So here was a woman who was at the centre of power in England and Normandy for many years. And it shows that despite people saying that women could not be powerful, could not have power, women were not able to make decisions, they were too emotional, they were too weak and so on. Despite all that talk, the truth is that there were always women who rose to powerful positions in society.
And a very important character, Aldred, the monk. Aldred's deepest wish is to create a center of learning, beginning with a total of 8 books, which is quite a large number at the time. What was the importance of books and learning at the time?
Well, a little of what was left of Roman and Greek civilization was preserved by the monks and priests throughout the Dark Ages. Not much. We lost a lot. For example, the works of Euclid, the great Greek mathematician who invented geometry. All of that was lost to Europe. Although Euclid was a European, he was Greek, we lost all of his works, and we would not have them today if it were not for the Arabs. The Arabs, the works of Euclid were preserved in Arabic in libraries in the Middle East and North Africa. We lost them, but what there was of literature and learning was preserved in monasteries and churches in the Dark Ages. And so that aspect of the monastic movement is very important. But also, this is a time when a few people are beginning to say there should be more of this. More people should be able to read. There should be more books. There should be more paintings, more pictures. And there was, from about the year 1000 onwards, there was a gradual increase in learning and culture in Europe. This was not just in England. And it was driven initially by the church. Even the great remnants that we have of medieval civilization, the great cathedrals, particularly in England and France, but also in Germany and Italy, these great cathedrals, they were driven by the church. It was the priests and the bishops and the abbots who wanted to build these fabulous churches. And so the reason the intellectual in my story, Aldred, is a monk, the reason he's a monk is that they were the intellectuals, they were the learned people. And really, the cultural heritage, the written cultural heritage, was in their hands.
So there are a lot of characters in your book. A lot of things happen. And in the French edition, the book is 850 pages long. But however, I think it could have been easily twice longer and, still have this power because of the structure of it. So when you're ready to write the first draft of the story, what's your methodology? Do you prepare a general plan for the story? Maybe do you work with a map?
I prepare a plan. I spend a long time working on the plan, between 6 months and a year. And at the same time as I plan, I do research for the book, because the two things go together, planning and research. I might be thinking about a scene and realize that I don't know enough about a particular subject. The next day, I'll read a book about that subject. And the book will answer my questions, but it will also give me new ideas for stories. So this process of research and planning together go on for up to a year. And at the end, I have an outline of perhaps 50 or 60 pages, which says what happens in every chapter of the book and who the characters are. And I don't write chapter one until I'm satisfied with that outline. So, yes, I'm a planner. I know many authors don't do this. Some of my friends don't. I know people who sit down and type chapter one, and then they think, now, what shall I write about? And it works for some people, and it's never worked for me. When I was starting out trying to make it as a writer, at first I did that. I typed chapter one, and then I thought, what shall I write about? And my early books were unsuccessful. I wrote several books that were published but were not bestsellers. And then the first book that I planned was Eye of the Needle, L'Arme à l'œil in French. And that was my first success, and it was the first book that I planned. And so planning and the research that goes along with planning became an absolutely standard part of my working method.
I do have a few questions about the historical fiction. So historical fiction is generally about making something new from something old, and it's an incredibly popular genre. So why do you think that people are attracted to this genre so much?
Well, certainly part of the attraction of the Middle Ages is that the people are like us, of course. 1,000 years ago, human beings were not very different from what they are today. They worried about the things that we worry about. We worry about love and marriage and family and children. We worry about money and employment. We worry about violence and war. And these are the things that people worried about 1,000 years ago and 2,000 years ago, I believe. However, the lives of medieval people were so different from ours. Their lives were much harder. They were hungry more often than we are, cold. They saw much more violence than we ever see. Middle Ages were very violent, and there was a lot of crime, much more, 10 times as much crime as there is today in the Middle Ages. So we can look at the Middle Ages, and as well as enjoying the excitement of a story about the Middle Ages, we can also enjoy our comfortable chairs and our warm houses, and maybe also our glass of wine, and also the feeling that we're safe in our houses, and we're very unlikely to be attacked or robbed or bombed. Certainly those of us who are enjoying our books in Western Europe, there are sadly places in the world where people don't feel that safe. But I think that's the appeal of stories about the Middle Ages. People like us, but living much harder lives. The stories are exciting, and we also have that feeling of being very glad that we don't live in the Middle Ages.
Because Pillars of the Earth was released 30 years ago, so have you noticed an evolution in the genre, in the audience, but also in the writings?
Well, there's certainly a change in the audience, because when I was writing The Pillars of the Earth, one of the reasons that my publishers had misgivings about this idea was that historical novels were not very popular. 30 years ago, historical novels were by no means the most popular genre. There were a few writers of historical novels, and they had their readership, they had their fans, but they were not big bestsellers. But The Pillars of the Earth was part of the reason why that changed. There was another book called The Name of the Rose, by Umberto Eco. And that also, that was a medieval story that was a huge bestseller. And so with two really popular books set in the Middle Ages, there was a change in the public taste, I think. I never really wanted to be classified as a writer of historical novels. And so, for example, in my books, I never make the way people talk to one another, I never try to make it sound old-fashioned, because that when I find that irritating as a reader. As a reader, I don't like that. People sometimes people in historical novels talk in sort of Shakespearean English, which sounds old-fashioned but is just about understandable to us now. And I always found that irritating, so I didn't do that, and I didn't think of myself as a historical novelist. But of course, I guess I am. That's what I've become. And it's so long as it's popular. I think you would find a difference if you compared today's historical novels with those of 30 years ago or more. I think you would find that today's are more modern. They don't feel quite so constrained. They're not as formal. Historical novels used to be a bit formal and a bit stiff. Mm-hmm. And everybody would talk very politely. And now you will get people in historical novels speaking in a colloquial way. And even swearing and so on, which of course they did. So I guess you would find that historical novels have relaxed a bit over the last 30 years.
And maybe that the rise of heroic fantasy through book series or TV series has created a new audience for historical fiction. I don't know if you are a reader of a heroic fantasy. Maybe not.
No, well, I'm not quite sure what you mean by heroic fantasy,
medieval fantastic.
Okay.
Well, yeah. Best example would be Game of Thrones, for example.
Yes, okay.
It has created maybe a new audience for medieval fiction.
Well, there's certainly a link, isn't there? Because Game of Thrones presents a world that is in some ways very like medieval England. Mm. And people say that it's based on the Wars of the Roses in the 15th century in England. But of course, there are supernatural aspects to Game of Thrones. And that's a mixture. I see what you mean now. That's a hugely popular genre. Loads and loads of books. People absolutely love it. It doesn't appeal to me very much, I must say. I like science fiction, but I don't really like fantasy, because for me, if apparently miraculous things happen, they must have a logical explanation. Okay. So I'm quite like stories about spaceships, mm-hmm. and, you know, traveling to distant galaxies and so on. But when dragons come into it and magic spells and witches and so on, then I start to feel, well, anything could happen. I don't enjoy that sort of story very much.
In order to make the drama more meaningful to contemporary readers, would you say that it's necessary to depart from historical reality, at least to some extent?
No.
Okay.
No, I absolutely don't believe that. And I go to a lot of trouble to make sure that the history in my stories is true history, is authentic history. And I would never change anything. Let me give you an example. There was 5 or 10 years ago, there was a wonderful novel, bestseller, called The Help. I don't know what it was called in French. It's an American novel. And it's set in the 60s. It's yes. about the civil rights movement. Do you know the book I'm yes, talking about?
It's by Catherine Stockett.
Yes, what's it called?
La couleur des sentiments in French.
La couleur des sentiments. That's a nice title. In that, so you won't remember this because it's a little detail, but towards the end of the book, the main character hears a Bob Dylan song called The Times They Are A-Changing, which is very appropriate for the story. And then there's an epigraph in which she says, that song was not written or recorded at the time of my story. It was later, but I put it in because it was so appropriate. Now, there's no harm in that. That's perfectly all right. I don't criticize her in the least, and it's a great novel. But I would never do that. So I would never, for example, I would never change. The Battle of the Somme was started on the 1st of July, 1916, and I would never say it started on the 2nd of July, even if I wanted to change, even if I might like to change the date for the sake of my story. I would never do that. In the evening and the morning, there's a battle of Exeter.
Yeah.
And we don't know when that battle started. We know which year, but we don't know what day of the year. And so I can make up a date for that if I want, because nobody knows the truth. So I can invent things, but never anything that contradicts history. I would feel that's cheating. I don't tell other authors what to do at all. It's up to each individual author to make a decision about that. But my decision is I never violate history.
I do have one last question, Ken Follett, because we all know that you are a cathedral enthusiast. You wrote a short book last year about the history of Notre-Dame de Paris, the profits of which will contribute to its reconstruction. And we, after much discussion, the cathedral will be rebuilt exactly as it was. It has been decided. So what are your feelings about that?
I think it's the right decision.
Okay.
I don't think the French people wanted a different cathedral. You know, it was a very big moment on the 15th of April last year on television when President Macron said, "Nous rebâtirons." That was, you know, the whole world. I was watching that. I'm not even French. I had tears in my eyes. The whole world heard that and said, thank heaven. And what everybody wants, but particularly, you know, it belongs to the French people. The French people don't want a modern cathedral. They want what they lost. Now, there is an opportunity here because in front of the cathedral, on the west side of the cathedral, there's a big square. And normally we have queues of people like a great snake standing in the sun for 2 hours waiting to get into the church. Now, what I would like to see is some kind of new entrance for visitors that might be a bit like what's in the Louvre. You know, the Louvre is mostly an 18th century palace, but in the middle of the courtyard, there is a very modern glass pyramid. And that's how you enter and you go down and brilliant. That kind of thing, I think something like that would be marvelous for the Cathedrale de Notre Dame. But the church itself, yes, we all want it to be exactly the same as it was before the fire.
Well, thank you very much, Ken Follett, for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure. So let's hope that next time we'll see each other, it will be in person. I wish you a nice afternoon.
Goodbye. Thank you. I enjoyed talking to you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for having me on your show.
Thank you very much. Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.